Fabrizio Genovese from the University of Oxford.
Hello. And presenting his work with Stefano. The real title should be How to Tensor a Lot of Infinite Dimensional Hilbert Spaces, Pretending that the Resulting Dimension is Finite. It sounds bollocks, but it's exactly what happens. First of all, you know when you are watching some YouTube video and there are those annoying ads popping on that you can't skip? This is ours, so please buy this book. It's a very nice book, lots of pictures, lots of donuts, and if you don't, Bob's get angry and I will never finish my PhD. Okay, so we start with a very naive idea of how to build a quantum field. It's basically you start with a space, for example momentum, and you want to describe what happens at every point with a quantum system, for example, a quantum harmonic oscillator. Then you tensor everything, and a state of this tensor product is a state of your quantum field. This obviously doesn't work usually, because what you get is something that is mathematically horrible. So usually you resolve to other solutions like Fock spaces, Bonhomian algebras, Cauchy-Darboy, and misery and tears. So everything is very complicated, but with no standard analysis, that is a theory many people are skeptical on, you can solve the problem. So we'll get to that later. First of all, in categorical quantum mechanics, infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces are quite bad. Many people here know that when you don't have Frobenius algebras, Diamond Compact Structure, and other stuff, you can't do a lot of the nice things you usually do in CQM. And this is why we usually use finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. With no standard analysis, we can basically do infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces keeping this stuff. So there is a tutorial out that I wrote for people that don't know much about no standard analysis. It's very short, less than 20 pages, very easy to read. No prerequisites at all, you just have to know how to do a derivative, so if you want to check it out. So what happens is this, you start with a real number, so whatever, usually real numbers, and you want to extend the real numbers, putting in infinites and infinitesimals, so that you can do limit constructions algebraically and not topologically. You do this with an ultra-powered construction that more or less works like this. You choose a subset of the set of subsets of the natural numbers with properties, namely you want a non-principal ultrafilter, but it's not a problem now. I mean, it's not important to know it now. It's very important to the thing. But anyway, you consider infinite sequences of real numbers like this. You induce ring operations on these sequences component-wise. And then you quotient saying that two sequences are the same thing when basically they differ only on a number of i's that are in the ultrafilter. So when they are, when they are almost everywhere equal, basically. And this means that they are equal on a number of i's that is in the ultrafilter. The quotient of these sequences is an ordered field called hyperreal numbers. In this framework, you get automatically infinites and infinitesimals, so you can interpret a standard real number as the equivalence class of a constant sequence. You have infinites, you can check that basically this guy is almost everywhere bigger than the standard sequence, and so you get new stuff that represent infinite real numbers. You have, in the same way, infinitesimals, like this. And with this construction, you can extend also sets, functions, and relations. So in here, for instance, you can say, okay, an extended set is just sequences, and sequences, equivalence classes of these sequences are in here when they are, these elements are almost everywhere in the set. For example, if you take the natural numbers, this guy is a non-standard natural. That is an infinite natural, for the same argument I showed you before with reals. Same way you have a negative infinite integer. And you can basically extend everything in this way. Now, the question is, you are formally introducing new elements in the real numbers or whatever. What's the link we with the structure you started with. What happens is that sets, functions, and relations are the basic ingredients of logical formulas. So once you can extend them, you can also extend logical formulas. And then you have this very nice theorem that is what makes everything possible, called transfer theorem, that basically tells you that every time a formula holds in a model, the extension holds in the extended model, and vice versa. I'll give you an example right now. So this one is the formula that tells you that every non-zero natural number has an antecedent, a predecessor, let's say. You can extend this, and since this is obviously true in the natural numbers, this will be obviously true in the non-standard natural numbers. This means that every non-standard natural will have a predecessor, basically. In the same way, this will be very useful later. You know that if you have two natural numbers and you do this, you get a natural number. You can extend this formula, and this will be true in the non-standard naturals, but this in particular means that when this is unlimited and this is unlimited, the product will still be a non-standard natural. And we will basically use these guys to denote the cardinality of our Hilbert spaces, so you can already start figuring out how we keep the cardinality low, even with infinite dimensional stuff. So, the first thing we do, we recast the category of Hilbert spaces as follows. Our objects are pairs where H is a non-standard Hilbert space and PH is a non-standard linear map from H to H that we call truncating projector that is self-adjoint and idempotent. And we know that there are non-standard naturals and a family of non-standard vectors that are basically a basis, such that this decomposition is true, this equation is true. This is true because of transfer theorem. So this is why we are able to say that. We have by transfer, yeah, that this D is unique, and we can basically call this the dimension of our Hilbert space, non-standard Hilbert space. This can be, by the way, now this can is a non-standard number, so it can be an unlimited. Morphisms are really defined in terms of a subcategory of the Karubi envelope, but it turns out you can just express them in matrix form in this way, exactly like you do in the finite case. The identity can be, again, expressed like this, very familiar. And yeah, we basically cracker product, conjugate transfer, and whatever. You have that this is a Dagger symmetric monodal category with non-standard complex numbers as fields of scalars. This is important later because you can basically multiply by unlimited scalars, like a scalar that is infinite. So you have a Dagger compass structure that you define more or less in the same way, like this. You consider an object and a decomposition. This guy is a state in Hilbert star that corresponds to this effect in H, exactly like you do in the finite case. You define the dual object like this, and again, you can define this truncating projector in terms of this, basically. And then you get cups and cups, exactly like we usually do. And you can do the trace, and again, when you do the trace of this guy, you get the dimension, as you would expect. Now, we can put all this to good use and start actually doing some physics with it. So, for instance, you can take the underlying Hilbert space of the non-standard L2 of R over Z to the N. You define momentum eigenstates, like you usually do. The dimension of this is this guy, when omega is now some infinite natural, because again, you are working in R, basically. And you have classical structure, like this. And basically, you can define with this a quasi-special commutative dagger from Hilbert algebra with this normalization factor. Again, this guy is infinite, but you don't really care because we are treating it as a non-standard natural. And what's happening here is that basically this is our abelian group, and this guy, from the non-standard perspective, is a cyclic group, but it's cycling beyond infinite. So you're basically trolling the situation and you're saying, okay, Zn is a proper subgroup that lives in here. So yeah, this is cyclic, but I'm cycling very far away, let's say. For this guy, you have classical states that basically need to be in this form. We can discuss about this later. It's related to basically the group of characters and whatever. But no, I don't have time to talk about this now. But basically, when x is in this form, these guys behave like Dirac deltas. And we call them position eigenstates, and this is the position of the observer. Case study, with this stuff we were able to prove graphically the wheel canonical combination relations using the strong complementarity of our observables. And yeah, the full graphical proof is on the paper, but basically you can see that we are able to use the standard graphical formalism in infinite dimension now to do, let's say, useful stuff. Now, this is one of my favorite parts. So you can basically use the fact that you have unlimited and infinitesimal numbers to approximate the real space with a lattice. So here is how it works mathematically. Basically, you choose two infinites, you choose this lattice, you basically embed it in this torus, and then you obtain the standard reals in this way. What's happening, and this is much easier, is this. You suppose you have a plane, okay? Now, we are tracing a grid on a plane that goes all the way up to infinity. This is an unlimited number. This is an infinite real. So, basically, your real plane is here. It's all contained to this order. And now, obviously, all these guys are quite far one from the other, so we rescale them, dividing them by an unlimited number. And so, basically, now all these guys come to be infinitesimally close one to the other. And so you know that for every real number in the plane, this real number will be infinitesimally close to some of these dots in the grid. So when you quotient everything and you say, okay, every two numbers that are on the grid that are infinitesimally close collapse to the same thing, you are sure you are hitting all the numbers, the real numbers of the plane. So you can use this lattice to actually approximate the real space. And this is exactly how Robinson, the guy that invented non-standard analysis, does differential geometry, basically. And now we can do what I was talking about before, our huge tensor product to build our quantum fields. So what we do is we take R to the n, we approximate it with a lattice of infinitesimal mesh. This is our lattice, this is the scalar we quotient it with to get everything infinitesimally close. This lattice has order 2 omega plus 1 to the n. This is the number of elements that are the lattice. We can pick the momentum space R3, for instance. Then we consider a non-standard quantum system, for instance, a quantum harmonic oscillator. And yeah, we write down the truncating projector for some orthonormal family, where D is the dimension, non-standard dimension of this upper space. And then for each point in this lattice, we associate a copy of the Hilbert space, and we take this huge tensor product by transfer theorem. Now we can basically define this orthonormal family by transfer, indexing basically a basis for this guy with strings like this. This means to every point of the lattice, I'm picking the blah basis vector of this guy. And we tensor for every point, and we get a lot of these, as many as there are these strings, and these are our basis vectors for this huge monster here. But yeah, traditionally this is uncountable, and this would be horrible. But, and this is again the thing I was telling you before, the overall dimension of this is d elevated to this. Now, we don't really care that this and this would be usually infinite, because these are totally legit numbers in our framework. So, as a consequence, we can basically index all these strings with a bijection like this, because these are as many as these are. And with this observation, we can define a truncating projector for our monster here, like this. Totally legit sum. This would be a divergent sum in, you know, the standard framework, but for us it's just a non-standard natural, eventually infinite, but what's the problem? And then, yeah, we are able to use this guy, basically. And this trick is the key of everything, and these were our faces when we got aware of this, like, whoa, really? And so, yeah, you can keep cardinality, let's say, low. I mean, the best thing is that this guy is not even separable for us. This is finite in our framework. So, yeah, with this now you can model, you can do stuff you usually do in quantum field theory. So, for instance, you basically say, okay, I get my Q Tilbert space with my Q Lattice operator that represents a quantum harmonic oscillator. I define the energy like this, and I take this guy, and this is Fock space for us. That is not, that's not restriction to finite energy, obviously, because I can have an infinite number of particles interacting on this space. You can define number operator and Hamiltonian like you usually do, and you can define, yeah, the field operator again that you usually do. What we are really doing is just defining a global Laguerre operator and point-wise. And, you can just count infinite things, that's it. You can extend finite dimensional combinatoric tricks to infinite stuff that should be infinite dimensional usually. And so you can, yeah, just do what I said in the introduction, attach to every point a Hilbert space that describes what happens in that point, and that's it. And you can do a lot of stuff with this. You can basically do everything you would like to do with infinite dimension, and you can use all the categorical gadget we developed till now. So, yeah, you can do this, and we are basically doing now, looking into a lot of other stuff that we could do with this formalism. And that's basically it. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Second order quantification in non-standard analysis is a bit tricky, but you can definitely, you are quantifying over internal sets, so that's not really a problem. You can absolutely overcome that. And again, by transfer, you obtain that the independence of bases still holds in the infinite dimensional case, so you don't have to do that. But
very cool.
Separable Hilbert space with which you start like L2 of a torus.
Wait a second. Here.
Yeah, next picture. Yeah, right. So then you have a way to get to kind of the non-standard version. That's basically just kind of freely adding non-standard scalars, or how can I imagine?
The way you go from the standard to the non-standard is completely canonical. The procedure to extend the Hilbert space is just, I mean, basically, Robinson gives you a logical recipe to do that. And so what you do, you just take the axioms defining your Hilbert space and you extend them. There is no creativity involved in that process, and that's probably one of the nicest things. You cannot fail because it's a unique recipe to do this.
No, but I mean, if you start with actual separate Hilbert space.
Yeah, what's the problem with that? Right. Yeah. You can, I mean, for us, it doesn't, what happens is that if you start with a finite dimensional Hilbert space and you extend, you get basically nothing really new. The dimension will be the same it was before. You'll get new vectors because you can have vectors that have, let's say, infinitesimal or infinite length, but the dimension will still be, instead of being equivalent to, let's say, c to the n, will be equivalent to star c to the n. But the point is, when you go to infinite dimension, separable, uncountable, doesn't matter. By transfer theorem, you can index this dimension now with a non-standard natural that is genuinely non-standard. So some omega, random omega that you don't know what omega is it, but you know that it exists and it's unique and it's everything you need. So then you take it there and you fiddle with it and you have fun.
So it seems like the recipe of this approach is basically you take some infinite dimensional number space that you want to work with, so like the torus or something like this, and then you equip it with a projector, and then you focus on things which only have support on this projector. And the fact is that you can make the dimension of this projector a non-standard number.
Natural number, yes. Yeah, it's exactly this.
So the underlying Hilbert space is the same, it's not a...
Yeah, I mean, now, Patrick, this is the difference from the paper we presented last year. In the paper we presented last year, all the underlying Hilbert spaces were standard Hilbert spaces, and we used non-standard naturals only to index the basis vectors. And this is why we could do only separable stuff. Now we don't have this limitation anymore because we are genuinely taking all the non-standard Hilbert spaces here, and your projector is the equivalent of saying I've chosen a basis, let's say, more or less. And then, yeah, actually when you define morphisms, since you are truncating the projector up to an arbitrary D, it's not really arbitrary, but the morphism between these non-standard Hilbert spaces are non-standard morphisms. And so you get that you can express these morphisms in this way, but what really happens when you define the category is that your morphisms are the form non-standard function composed before and after with the truncating projector. So the idea is, otherwise, you know, you could have something in that comes out to be too much infinity, much more than your D. So what you'd say is, I don't give a shit, I got, and this is what I'm using. So in the paper this is explained much more in detail, but yes, let's say that more or less this is what happens. So we are using non-standard Hilbert spaces and we are carrying up to something that the nodes are dimension.
So earlier we had a talk about where they used epsilons, and here there's infinitesimals, and I can't help but wonder, is there some relation to be made? There they were multiplying epsilon by some m and they didn't really care because it's still close enough.
Honestly, I was quite panicking for my talk before, so I didn't pay too much attention. And I hope you can forgive me for that.
Yeah. Ask you. Anyway, let's thank our speaker.